Good morning, Valley View. If I could get everybody to come on in. If you're like me, this cold weather kind of makes me move a little faster sometimes. Welcome. Thank you. That had to be Stacy. She's the only one that would tell me that. Thank you. Come on in. I'm going to start us off with a word of prayer, and then we'll get into some other great things. So if you'll join me, please. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We love you. And we just ask that we could be your best disciples that we can be. Show us your will. Guide us. And thank you for your Holy Spirit each day. In your Son's name, amen. All right, this is the best time. Let's stand and greet each other. I know most of you have already done that, but take a few minutes and we'll greet each other again. All right, I have a few announcements as you come back to your seats. The first announcement is I want to publicly thank the ladies group that meets on Thursdays. They sent me a card this last week, said they were praying for me. I needed that. So thank you, ladies. They signed it, and I know these are not all the ladies that show up, but they usually meet every Thursday. I think they have a Bible study, and then they send out cards to people. And Nan, I believe, are you in charge of that group that leads the Bible study? Sometimes she leads, so they share. Sounds like they share. But I want you to know, ladies, that go on Thursday, thank you. This card meant a lot to me. Even though you're retired and you get older, you still have down times, you know. So thank you. I appreciate it. Pastor Gavin is in Six Flags with 19 teenagers. So we're praying that he makes it back home today. Okay? So that's the last thing that we heard. They're supposed to be back about 8 o'clock, 8:30. So pray for them. I'm sure they had a great time. He sent me a text, so here's the announcements also. Fall Festival is October the 28th from 2 to 4 p.m. If you can, help see Pastor Jill. So she needs volunteers. Last year, this place was packed. I mean, kids were everywhere, and parents too. It was really a lot of fun. So that's October the 28th. And parents, or grandparents, or aunts and uncles, if you are associated with teenagers and you want to learn more about them, that's so scary, we have an in-house doctor. Well, we have several doctors, but we have one that kind of likes teens, and she's had some training, and it's Kendra McLaughlin. I don't know what's wrong with this lady, but she likes teens. Anyway, she is willing to give her expert help and advice to those that work with teens that have, like I said, an aunt or an uncle or grandparents or anybody that wants to know more about teens. She is starting, I don't know, a clinic, a group. Oh, read it up there. You know, Pastor didn't tell me he had a slide, so anyway, let's just read it up there. It starts next Sunday here at the church from 4 to 5 p.m. And I believe it'll three-part. So what happens, Kendra, if you can't make the first part? Are you able to come for the second? So it's okay if you can't make the first one. I thought there was a book that you're going with, too. So how do they get the book? You don't have to have the book, but you can order it or just show up without it. So that's all the announcements I have. Aren't you glad? Except Pastor Gavin also said, and I'm going to keep this in my text, you're the best. Okay, let's stand and have some worship time. Thank you, Jesus.
the earth to the sky. Let it rise, let it rise. The dark into light. Now alive, now alive. We are here to lift you up. Here to sing a song of love. Here to give you, God, what you are worthy of.
Oh, This morning to know that we have a God that reigns forevermore. There's no end to it. So many things are uncertain in this world, and 2 Corinthians 5 tells us to not focus on the things we see, but on the things we do not see. Because the things that we see are temporary, but the things that we do not see are eternal. That means forever. Y'all please pray with me this morning. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord. Father, we need you. Holy Spirit, you are welcomed in this place. Father, I pray that each of us that are in this congregation this morning, if we have things going on in our minds, the noise that happens with us about the world that surrounds us, perhaps we can just quiet in that for a little bit. And Lord, let you just come and nourish us this morning. Father, help us open our hearts and our minds to you. Invite the Spirit in, Lord. Let us invite the Spirit in, Lord, and just be nurtured this morning. Father, we thank you. You're so good to us. It's your name we pray. Amen. Good morning again. I guess y'all seen y'all got the luck of the draw. Sorry, Gavin is, I'm jealous this morning. He's in Six Flags. But I will say the last time, I went Six Flags, probably 6 or 7 years ago. And I find in my older age, I'm not near, I'm not near as challenging. I don't do things I used to do. I won't get on rides that I used to get on. I look at something now and they, no, thank you. Where before is like, heck yeah, let's go. But anyway, I hope that he comes back in one piece. I do hope that, in more than one respect, okay? So anyway, this morning, we are still in ordinary time, but the big idea this morning is about praise. And I know y'all know me. I'm in somebody that praises, and I'm not bragging, but I am going to tell you a little bit about why I am the way I am about praise. Many of us have stories about our past and things about that, but God took somebody that was so broken and was finished with this world, finished with life, and turned that upside down, turned that into something completely different than what I ever thought it could be, beyond my father's imagination. So, yes, I'm going to praise God. Every moment of every day, I'm going to praise God, because he deserves that. He deserves more than I can give him. But I'm going to praise God. So this particular story is in the book of Luke, chapter 17, verse 7. And it's in what they call this particular part of the Bible. It's one of the books that I was looking in calls it the travel narrative. And what it's talking about is a group of stories from the time of Jesus' baptism to basically the Last Supper. And now in these stories, if you look, there's all kinds of stories of healing and all kinds of different things. And most of the stories, like this one today, kind of has a radical twist to it. Kind of a radical way of looking at things. But I want to do something a little bit different this morning than we usually do. Those of you that can, I want us to stand this morning as I read our scripture to us. Got it up here on the board? Yeah, we do. Okay. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him, keeping their distance. They called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." As they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself in front of Jesus, at Jesus' feet, and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you clean." The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. So one of the first things that we see here in the story at the top of it here is it says, on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was on his way. So all through this part of the Bible, Jesus on the way. As I mentioned, from the time that he is baptized, Jesus is on his way to the cross. But it says he was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. Do you have the map, please? Okay. We have this up here, and I want to look at this for a minute. And it's important for us that he was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. Now, Luke makes it sound like the region between is some kind of land in between Samaria and Galilee. But if you look up there where the blue line is, there's no separation. You go from Galilee right into Samaria. Now, another thing I found interesting is that's where Jesus was born, was in Nazareth. Well, way down here is Judah. You can't see the line, but there's another line there just on the side of Joppa that separates Samaria to Jerusalem. So Jesus had to travel all the way through the Samaria, and you notice that Galilee's a small place, and Jerusalem's not that big either, but Samaria is huge. It's a big place. So Jesus, we know there's bunches of stories We know Jesus' mother lived in Nazareth. We know there was his brothers did and all these other things. So they traveled through that area quite a bit. But I found it interesting that Luke is talking about a region in between, like there's some kind of space between the two countries, and there's not. But so what he was talking about was Jesus traveling back and forth through that area. Now, what's significant about Samaria in the story? I told you it's kind of a radical story, what we're going to look at today about Samaria. Samaria, the Samaritans and Samaria in general, was a place where the Jews, you would not find a Jew. Because it was a forbidden place. The Samaritans were considered half-breeds. Now, this is, for me, it's kind of ironic that they're considered that. And up to this point, the Samaritans and the Jews still didn't get along. It's kind of like the Hatfields and McCoys back in the 20s. You know, the Hatfields and McCoys killed each other for years and years and years. And you would ask them, why are you killing your neighbor? I don't know. It's just what we do. Well, that's why the Samaritans and the Jews were a lot. They were still having problems over something that happened probably 700 or 800 years before this point. Something that happened a long time ago. And the funny thing about it is, or the ironic thing about it is, the Samaritans, that group of people, probably wouldn't have been in existence if it hadn't have been for the Jews worshiping false gods. God told them, it started with Solomon, but Solomon began to worship false gods. And after that, it continued. And God told them, he said, if you don't quit that, he warned them and warned them, told them, if you don't quit it, I'm going to level this place. So he did. The Babylonians came in and they burnt the city, burnt all the buildings, burnt everything there, and they took everybody out of that area and took them to Babylon for about 70 years. So now I'm going to get the good part, how the Samaritans come about. But they left a remnant of people there in Judah. It said that the poorest of poor people they left there to take care of the land. So they left some of the poorest Jews there in that area at that time. So during those 70 years, some Gentiles moved in. And the Gentiles and the Jews intermarried. And that's where the Samaritans come about. So here we have the Jews have a problem with the Samaritans, which wouldn't have even been a group of people if it hadn't have been for their own disobedience. That's the way it works, isn't it? That's the way it usually happens. So anyway, very interesting part of the story. And you need to know this because where the story's going. Okay, it says, as Jesus entered a village. Now, the nearest I can tell, the village was in Galilee. Now, I looked to see if it was a place we're going to see 10 lepers approach him. But anyway, I looked to see if it was a sanctuary village, and I couldn't find anywhere that it said it was. So according to Jewish tradition, the lepers had to live outside of the city. But it says, as he entered the village, 10 lepers approach him. Keeping their distance, they call out, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Now this, they call out, that word call out. I've done some looking about leprosy. And I doubt very seriously that they may have called out, but it was probably more like, Jesus, help us, have mercy on us. Because leprosy was such a horrible, horrible disease. It started on your skin, and then wherever you touched on your body, it would go. It would also be transferred by your breath, by your spit. It would also happen the same way. So these lepers have been isolated. I begin to think about how can we even think about that? In 2020, America experienced some isolation that I don't think anybody could ever imagine from COVID. It was an isolation that we couldn't even imagine. In April of 2020, naturally, I got COVID. Church was still going. I got pneumonia. It was bad. I called Pastor Larry and I said, "Hey, I've got pneumonia. I got COVID." He said, "Well, first thing is get well. Don't go to the hospital. Get well." Doctor was coming to see me at home, saved my life. But he said, "Get well." Then the next thing he told me is, "You can't come back to church until you've been tested." Well, at that point, there wasn't any place to go get tested. There wasn't no home tests to do like there are now. So I called the city, the CDC, I guess it is, and made an appointment. And they said, "Well, go out to the fairgrounds in your car and get in line." So I went out there and got in line, drove through this line off of 3rd Street around there, and I pull up into this barn, into this big tin building in my truck, and there's two women that approach me that look like they're in spacesuits. You know, I roll down my window, and one of them checks my temperature and asks my name, and the other one swabs my nose, and they sent me on my way. But that was a strange experience, to say the least. But the next thing, I waited, I think, 7 days to get an answer. It came back negative. I didn't have COVID anymore. So I was able to come back to church and work in the food pantry. I was kind of taking care of the food pantry at that time. But it was definitely an experience that I never experienced before. Now, shortly after that, the church closed. We had guidelines saying that we weren't supposed to be in the house with our loved ones. Separate, go home and get in different rooms, stay in different places. So we can only, through that, imagine kind of how these lepers felt. They were shunned out of the city, out from everything. If they come around anybody, everybody come around, they said, "Unclean, unclean, unclean, I'm unclean." So everybody would stay away from them. So this is interesting that these 10 lepers, I find it interesting that they had heard of Jesus. And now these 10 lepers, their fate was very dark. They were going to die. You don't recover from leprosy. So they seen Jesus, and they approached him, keeping their distance, and they called out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And when he saw them, he said, I love this, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." And as they went, they were made clean. Now, one thing I see interesting about this, we know very well that in the Bible that Jesus could have fairly, very easily spoke them clean. Just like he did in the story of Lazarus. Lazarus had been in the tomb for days, and Jesus is standing outside. "Lazarus, Lazarus, come out!" And he came out. So Jesus could have just very simply spoke them clean. But he wanted, there was something more to it. They had to make an effort. They had to make an effort. And then there was something else as well. And how often does this happen with us? Many times we pray about things. And then as we're going, after we pray, as we're going, Jesus heals us. Things begin to happen. And I believe that's what was happening here. As they were walking, and I can only imagine, it makes me smile thinking about it, as they were walking towards the priest. Now, he told them to go see the priest. I imagine some of them thought, how in the world are we going to make it to a priest? We can't even walk across the street. How are we going to make it there? But as they begin to walk, they begin to heal. What an amazing story, isn't it? How God can do that. Another one of these radical stories that we see in this particular part of the Bible, how God heals. It says they were made clean. And then one of them, this is where the story's going this morning, one of them, when he saw he was healed, now, this particular one, we'll see who he is here in a second, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, praising God, "Thank you, Jesus, for healing me." And he prostrated himself in front of Jesus' feet and thanked him. And here's the hiccup. He was a Samaritan. So here we have basically an enemy of the Jews who God has healed, Jesus healed, praising God, at his feet, praising him. And then Jesus says, were not 10 made clean? The other 9, where are they? Now from there, as I can tell, the others must have probably been Jews. Now the Samaritan, he had no reason to go see the priest because he didn't care. He's not a Jew anyway. But the others, they were Jews. They needed to go see the priest. So when they went and seen the priest, two things happened. Now we have to understand that most of the time they related leprosy as a sin. You sin, that's why you have that. So two things happened. One is they were proclaimed to be physically clean and spiritually. And then they were allowed back into society. But these other 10, these other 9 rather, they went on their way. The priest said they were clean, they were allowed back in society, and they went right on their way, never stopping or coming back to praise God for what he had done. How often do we make that mistake? I taught a class one time, and I told them, I said, I want y'all to get a piece of paper out, make 2 columns. And you can think about the last year, the last month. Write in one column the bad things that have happened, and write in the other column what God has done for you in the last month. Well, you can imagine what column filled up first. Because we forget on a daily basis what God does for us. We shouldn't, but we do. It says, were 10 not made clean, but were the others? Was none of them found to return to give praise to God except this foreigner? All the bad blood, all the things that had happened meant nothing at that point. Now, another thing I see about the foreigner is, yeah, he was cleansed physically, but he needed much more. And this pierces my heart about this particular part of the story, is he needed something. He needed that forgiveness from God. He needed that transformation that can take place when we come to God. So then Jesus says, get up and go on your way, for you're all well. So from this point, I want to go to Hebrews for just a minute. And let's look what he says in chapter 13, verse 15. It says, through him, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise that is the fruit of our lips confessing in his name. Now, I love what this says. Through him, let us continually offer a sacrifice. Now, we know the Old Testament, through the Old Testament, that there had to be blood involved. Well, Jesus paid for that. Jesus spilt all the blood that needs to be spilt. There's no more necessary to be spilt. That price has been paid. But for us, there still needs to be a sacrifice. And I love what it says here. A sacrifice of praise. Praise team, would y'all please make your way back up? A sacrifice of praise to God that is the fruit of the lips that confesses his name. It says, do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Do we realize that just praising God is something that is pleasing to God? Two more pieces of scripture here for us this morning. This is in Psalms 66. It says, make a joyful noise to God. All the earth sing the glory of his name and give him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Because of your great power, your enemies cringe before you. And all the world, all the earth worships you. They sing praise to you, singing praise to your name. The other one is 67. I love this piece of scripture. May the God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine upon us. I'm going to read that again. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine upon us. That your way may be known upon the earth, your saving power among all the nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let the peoples praise you. Say amen. Amen. Come on. Amen. Amen. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy and judge the peoples and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the people praise you, O God. Let the people praise you. Again, the earth has yielded its increase, and God, our God, has blessed us. And may God continue to bless us and let it to the ends of the earth worship him. Amen. Amen. So my message is this morning is praising God. I hope that, you know, God tells us to come to him first in the morning. God doesn't require much of us. But as we see, he really likes us praising him. So come unto God first in the morning and praising him through the throughout the day. And always before I lay my head down at night, I like to praise God and help thank him for what he's done for the day. So as we move forward from today, I begin to think about a friend of mine that's here. I've known him, I don't know, about 15 years, I guess. And I've seen him go through some horrendous things, and still is. And I think there's a song about this, but through it all, I've seen him praise God. Amen? So help us remember.
Father, Father. Mark 2:16-17. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. And Father, this morning, we run to you. You do not call us to be perfect. You just call us to come to you and put all our trust and faith and hope in you, because you provide everything that we need. Father, we lift up our voices to you this morning, and thanks for all you're doing in our lives and in this church. And we thank you for this time together, and ask that you lead and guide us throughout this coming week. We love you and we worship you, and it's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen." You are dismissed.